And particularly last night's game would have been, and it's the stock phrase you'll hear, is a wonderful advertisement for the game, but standing on its own 2 feet, that was a fantastic game of football last night. And the United States managed to just about get over the line. England, I don't think in terms of quality, may have stood toe-to-toe with the States, but perhaps unlucky not to at least force extra time last night.
Well, with the penalty kick, as I say, I was 15 yards away for the penalty kick when it happened, and then I'm right at the corner where she's Millie Bryce taking the penalty kick into, and you know how close it was. Tactically, it was quite interesting as well. The Americans tactically are good. They're a wee bit ahead of everyone else. And of course, Jill Ellis, she's got everything right all the way through this tournament, even when it's ugly, and it has been ugly a couple of times as well. Phil Neville went for a 4-4-2, which, you know, try and ignore the fact it's women's football. You're going to go and play against not only the world's best team, but the team that's been best in the world for decades. And then you go with a 4-4-2, which is about the most open system you can play. Like, what? You know, if it had worked, genius, mate. Absolutely brilliant. So impressed with. Thing is, it didn't work. They were 2-1 down. When he went back to his normal system, 4-2-3-1, with the players where they all know what to do, and there's, you know, slab A's and slot B, they were the better team. And they got stronger as the game went on. And they got that penalty. And they were so unlucky with that goal that was ruled offside, which was just marginally offside. So, yeah, there was nothing in it. They're getting closer. They know that. But everybody knows that the Yanks were miles ahead, but they ain't anymore. So that's why it was exciting. It's hard for me sometimes to tell. If you're right on the touchline watching a game with 50,000 people, you can get a little bit carried away with the excitement of it. But it did seem like a right good game of football.
What was your view on the penalty? Because I know we had several, several hundred in terms of a bit of hyperbole and reviews and rewinds of that particular incident. But it strikes me that with VAR, and it's probably a general complaint about VAR, if you're looking for something within a VAR replay, if you look at it enough times, you're going to convince yourself that you see it. I don't know if that was the case last night.
It could have been. I'll tell you, I didn't watch the VAR because I'm right beside it.
Right.
And immediately I went penalty kick, immediately, because I heard something. I heard a noise.
The snickometer on Pat Nevin was working no while.
Honestly, it was that close to it.
Yeah.
And also, sometimes just the way people fall, the difference between an act and a clip at pace, the way you sort of bend over. Also, her reaction was anger as much as anything else. It wasn't like, there doesn't seem pretense there. So, you know, I'm not seeing VAR, and I'm getting people in my ear saying, oh, they're checking it, and I'm saying, well, I'm going to call this early. I think that was a penalty kick. Yeah. I haven't said that. I got the offside wrong. That was onside. I was amazed that was offside. But again, with the VAR, it's been much better since the, you know, they've got used to it. They've got better referees that are capable of using when it's needed. Certainly, it's not getting stopped every 20 seconds now. They're not leaning on it as much as they were before. When it's a major decision, they're going to it now. And they've generally got the decisions right. And FIFA is going to come out. I mean, it was listening to the stuff that Kalina was saying the other day. They're going to come out and they're going to throw a bunch of stats at you. They say they've increased the number of decisions they've got right. The only thing that I've got a problem with, but I think many people have got a problem with, is they changed a couple of the rules. And those rules, people were blaming in VAR, but it wasn't VAR. Blaming, you know, some of these penalties with the arms just out. That's a change in the rules. That's not the VAR. That was how they were interpreting the rules for this tournament. Now, to be honest, they laxed off that a wee bit as soon as you get by the group stage. And the other rule, obviously, you know, was always the rule, the one about the goalkeeper standing on the line. But it can break down now that we've got into the group stages. It's going to take a wee while for it, but bad news to everyone who's against VAR, you ain't going back.
Yeah,
you can.
Yeah. That toothpaste then going back in the tube. On the tactical front, as you mentioned, Jill Ellis making a couple of interesting calls last night. I suppose the one that jumped out when the teams came out was the lack of Megan Rapinoe in the United States side. It seemed initially that it was a tactical call because they figured that Kristen Press might be able to offer more defensively up against Lucy Bronze than perhaps Rapinoe may have done. Then we get the reports that, you know, Rapinoe had a bit of tape on her hamstring the day before in training and she may or may not have been fully fit, etc., etc., etc. What did you make of that particular call?
Well, obviously, when they came on for the warm-up, and by that time we knew the teams had been announced, they came out for the warm-up and Rapinoe went for the tiniest little warm-up and then stood at safe. And I thought, yeah, no way you're fit. No chance in the world you're fit. She clearly was worried about it. She didn't even do, I would say, 10% of the warm-up. And you don't do that if you're going to play a professional football game. And at no point did she warm up at sides either, to any way at all. She was nowhere that she was considering she was fit. So, press was brought on. Obviously, she'd come on before in the tournament. She looked really, you know, really sharp. She obviously scored that great goal. Yeah. Lucy Bronze didn't get much involvement in the game going forward, maybe only a couple of times. To be honest, I wouldn't put that down to press. I would put that down to the different system that England played. They played 4-4-2, not the normal winger, Nikita Paris, and ahead of Lucy Bronze, where she can work with someone she knew. And Nikita Paris was playing, you know, one off the front and just didn't know how to play the position. So it was a mess. It was a shambles and a mess in that first half, because it was just, they weren't square pegs and square holes. And press and the others, I mean, press did well, but the one that got me was anybody who watched it last night, a girl called Rose Lavelle was playing, and she just looked phenomenal. Yeah. On the other hand, if you've got three in midfield against two and you're the third one, hell of a easy to look quite phenomenal, because you've got nobody marking
it. It just seemed like I want to get on to the Netherlands and Sweden before we let you go, but it just seemed a remarkably naive call from Phil Neville to operate just two in midfield against, like, it's whatever, operating two against three in midfield. It's the best three midfield, it's the best midfield in the world from women's perspective. It's insane.
But, I mean, beyond me. The only way I could think of it, because you have to try and get inside the head, maybe overthinking it. This sometimes happens to international managers. He has actually gone on record as saying he's been preparing for that specific game for 18 months. So I suspect he has overthought it slightly.
Yeah.
But the other thing, more than anything else, I think they're all feeling they're getting close to the States now. And maybe he just overcooked it and thought, we're there. We'll level them. We can battle them. We can fight them. We can bully them.
Yeah.
But they weren't. They're not there. They're just still behind. And also, having been at, that's my third States game that I've been to see in this tournament. That was by far their best. By miles their best. Tobin Heath in the right wing was fantastic. You know, you mentioned press as well. But, you know, that whole midfield looked much, much better. But the liveliness and the sharpness of that attacking group, that's the best they've seen. And to be fair, Alex Morgan hasn't played brilliantly. But I'll use the word advisedly. It was a beautiful goal from a beautiful player. And I'm not being sexist, I promise you. She is just an incredible human being to watch in close quarters. She's like a statue. She's like, you know, a goddess. It's amazing to watch her move. And she's past what were her best days now. But there's no... When you see her in the flesh, in the person, you just know... You know why the entirety of America is in love with her. Mm. And Carly Lloyd the same. You just know it. You just stand there and go, yeah, I'm a film star. It's one of them ones. And an aura around them.
It's going to take something quite special to break that aura on Sunday. It's going to be up to either the Netherlands or Sweden to do it. Who do you see coming through this one tonight?
Well, once again, I've been to a lot of games in this tournament. I've really got around the country, and it's been great fun. I'm going to actually be back in the UK for the final. I had to get back for that one, so this is my last game. And I'm kind of happy I've seen these two teams, because their attitudes have been brilliant, but they're so stunningly similar. There's honestly, I cannot drag anything between the two of them. A couple of players, if anyone's not watched him, it's a player called Aslani. He plays for Sweden, number 9. Lovely player, beautiful player, great vision. Doesn't work remarkably well when she's been closed down and there's no space. As games open up, she's like a classic number 10. She just takes off and she plays ping balls all over the place. Great player. The girl called Jacobson, who plays alongside her in the last game, she was fantastic as well. If you look at the Netherlands, they were my kind of outside bets to maybe sneak this tournament because of how well they did in the Euros. But even though I've seen them a few times, I've not been as impressed with them, to be honest. There's good players. Nia Dema, she's up front. I mean, we've all seen them, and I know in Ireland, no names, no pack drill. We've all known centre forwards that they can't play very much, but they can score a goal, right? Well, she's one of them. Mm-hmm. She can score a few goals. It's not a great all-round player. And then you look at Martins on the left-hand side, she has a much better player. A player called Spitzer in the midfield. One of those ones that everyone overlooks, but without her, they'd have no chance. What I'm saying is, they're two fairly good teams. I can't call between them who's going to the final, but I can tell you neither of them's going to win that final.
Yeah, fair enough. Fair, absolutely fair. When you said you weren't going to be in France for the final, I presumed you were going to be back and coming over here to Dublin, seeing New Order playing in Trinity College, because they're there on Sunday night.
Sadly, even something even beats that. My daughter, after 7 years of university, is graduating on Saturday, so I need to be home for that. That beats everything.
Pat, that's ridiculously selfish on her part. She really should not think about this.
7 years, could she not have attained it there?
I know, it's ridiculous. Maybe you could have a word and try and sort out a phone call or two and try and get that rearranged and be over here for New Order. See Barney and Colin Sunday. Pat, we'll let you go. Enjoy the game tonight.
Look forward to it.
Cheers, thanks for everything.